Welcome back, Algebra 3. We're in lesson 45A. This is a two-part lesson, so we'll have a 45B as well. We're going to talk about conditional permutations. So a conditional permutation is a permutation with a condition set upon it. And there's not a whole lot you can do as far as a formula is concerned for setting these up because each one is different. So you just have to read the problem and figure it out. So let's just jump into 45.1 and see what we're talking about. So with 45.1, it says, how many odd counting numbers can be formed from the digits 3, 4, and 5? And we want odd counting numbers. All right. So we could have one digit, two digit, or three digit, because we have three digits here. But there's nothing limiting us from using all three, and there's nothing that says we have to use all three, so we could use one, two, or three. So let's look at that. Of the three that we're given for the one digits, right, one digit numbers, one of them is even, so we can't use it. So we have two is all we can use. So for the one digit, we have 3 and 5 are odd counting numbers. So the first number we have is 2. That's all we have. Now for two digits. All right. All that has to make it odd is that the second digit be odd, right? So we could have 43. We could have 45. We could have 53. We could have 55. So with the two digits, we could have either the 5 or the 3. Oh, and there's no repetition. No repetition. So either one of the 3 or the 5 could be back here. And if we take one of them away, then that leaves 2 remaining for the first number. So we have 2 times 2, that equals, this equals 2, this equals 4. So we have 4 options. We could either have 35 or 45, or we could have 53. Yeah, I think that's all we can use. I think that's all we can do for this second one. We got 43. We could have 45. Then we could have 53. Or we could have 35. That's all we can do. Those are our only options for two digits. So that's it. All right. And so in our three-digit possibility, we have 3 spaces here. We could select one of the 2 odd number digits. So that leaves 2 remaining to choose from. All right. So then we could pick either have the one left, whatever it is. And that is going to be our calculation. 1 times 2 times 2. And we can verify that. That's going to be 4. So we could have 345. Right. 345. Or 435, and that's if we pick 5 to be the last digit. Let's say we pick 3 to be the last digit, right? So then we could have 3 is the last digit. So it would be 543, or we could have 453. That's all we could do. Those are the only things that we can do for the 3 digit. And we chose from one of these. And whatever's left was whatever's left because we can't repeat any of the numbers. So there's only 4 options there. And that was it. Same thing here. We went over those. So now we just add these together. 2 plus 4 plus 4. That's going to be 10. We have 10 possible solutions for odd counting numbers using 3, 4, and 5 with no repetition. that's it. So you see, you really just kind of have to identify what's going on and create your own way of calculating it and set it up per. Let's look at 45.2. They're not as hard as the abstract rate calculations that we did just in our previous lesson, but they're still, you know, a little hard. So this one says to find the number of odd three-digit counting numbers that are less than 600. Okay, so the number of odd three-digit counting numbers that are less than 600. Okay. The statement of the problem indicates that repetition is permissible. It does not say anything about no repetition. It just says that they have to be less than 600. So our maximum number is 599, right? 599. So it's going to be X is going to be less than or equal to 599. That is going to be our condition for odd three-digit counting numbers. So let's look at our numbers that we have here. So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Those are our digits. So now we're going to select the odd ones because that is what is necessary in the ones position for it to be an odd number. 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. So we have 5 here. So we can have one-digit numbers, we could have two-digit numbers, and we could have three-digit numbers that are less than 599 or equal to 599, all right? So, right, for the first digit number, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It could be, we could use all five of those. So that equals 5. For the two-digit numbers, actually, I think I'm going to shift these to make this a little bit easier to see. I think that's going to line up a little bit better for my math. So again, in the ones place, we could use all five of those, right? But then when we get to the second place, we can use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 of those because if 0 goes here, then that is not going to, that's not going to work because it would go back to being a one-digit place. So we can only use 9 of these. Let me check my book. It's on a different page. I'll make sure that I'm doing that right. Yeah, so we could only use 9 here. Oh, you know what? It did specify, I'm sorry. It did specify three-digit counting numbers, so I can't do these. I can only do this one right here. I can only do the three-digit. See, I gotta pay attention to that language there. Three-digit counting numbers. That's the only things I can do is odd three-digit counting numbers. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is gonna be in the ones place. Because it's a three-digit number, I can do all 10 of these because I could have a 0 right here and it would still be odd. So I can put all 10 right here. But if it's going to be less than 599, okay, 9 is one of these, 9 is one of these. I can only do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these digits, for it to be less than 599 or less. Because if I do 0, it goes back to being a two-digit number, and that's not acceptable. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I could only have 5 here. So 5 times 10 is 50. 50 times 5 is 250. So I could have 250 odd three-digit counting numbers that are less than 600 from the 10 numerals that we have here. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah, I should have paid attention to this sooner so I could have seen that. So we have, let's see, 1, 2, 3 more of these. Let's check them out. Let's clear the page and do 45.3. And I'll try to quit rambling quite so much. So we have 5 math books. All right, 5 math books. Yay. And 4 English books are on a shelf. 4 English books. How many permutations are possible if the math books must be kept together and the English books must be kept together? Okay, how many permutations? That's the order of the books if the subjects must be kept together. Because of the nature of what we're doing, we have books on a shelf. We can't duplicate the books. The books are physical. They're in our hands. We're just talking about how many different ways can we arrange them on the shelf if we keep the subject matters together. Well, we have 9 of these books in total. So we're going to make 9 different things here. Right? That's going to be for the English books. And here is for the math books. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, so here's the math books. So I have 5 math books. So I could put them, I can't use repetition. Because once I put a math book in place, it's removed from what's left behind. So here I could use any of the 5. I then could use any of the 4 remaining, any of the 3 remaining, any of the 2 remaining, and then the last remaining one. For the English books, it's the same thing. I could use any of the 4, any of the 3 left, any of the 2 left, any of the 1 left, right? So 1 times 2 is 2, times 3 is 6. 6 times 4, that's 24. And then, actually, I could just do 4 exclamation point times 5 exclamation point, and that is going to be 2,880. And that's if I put the English books and then the math books. So what if I reverse it and decide to do the math books and then the English books? So if I swap them out and do the math books first, then that's going to be 5 exclamation point, and then I do the English books. That's going to be times 4 exclamation point. It's going to be the same number, 2,880. So the total number of permutations would be 0, 6, 7, 5. 5,760 permutations of the order of the books on a shelf if I keep the 2 subjects together. All right, that one was kind of fun. Let's do another one, 45.4. All right, how many different 4-digit odd? So 4-digit odd numbers can be formed if no repetition of digits is permitted. Oh, so we could go all the way up to 9,999, right? 4-digit odd, no repetition. All right, those are our constraints or our conditions. So let's just look at it and see. So I need 4 blocks here. All right, and I am going to, I've got 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. My odd digits are 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. Okay, so if I use one of these odd ones in the ones place, that is going to be the opportunity for it to be odd. So I have 5 opportunities for it to be odd. Now that's going to take away one of my odd numbers. So now I can only use 4 of my odd digits remaining. So if I take away one of the odd digits, then I have 9 digits remaining for this number. Okay, and now that I've used one of the remaining numbers, that one goes away. So now I have 8 digits remaining. And then I have, that one goes away, so now I have 7 digits remaining. Is that right? No, that's not right. Why is that not right? Let's look at that. So I had 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. These are my odd ones. I had 5 odd ones. Okay. So that's 5. Okay, I see now. The 4-digit number cannot begin with 0 because if it did, it would be, at the most, a 3-digit number. So there are only 8 choices left for the first digit. All right, I see what they're doing. Let's go with that. All right. So I cannot use 0, and one of my digits went away. So for this, I can only use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I can only use 8 of those. Now, once I've used that one of these that was available, it goes away. But for the second digit, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 still remain. All right, I see what I did wrong. And then that takes away another digit. So now I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 remaining. Okay, so I see exactly what I did wrong. I didn't take into account taking away the 0 for that first digit, which you have to kind of think about. It's, you know, a lot of this math we're doing is all logic. And especially with these conditional permutations, there's a lot of logic going on. So now I can multiply these and get my answer. And when I say 8 times 8 times 7 times 5, my answer is going to be 2,240. And I trust that you can plug those into the calculator yourself. All right, let's look at 45.5. This is the last example problem for this section. Okay, an elf, all right, this sounds like a really bad joke, y'all. An elf, a gnome, a fairy, a pixie, and a leprechaun all walk into a bar. No, it's not one of those. I promise, it's not a bad joke. Elf, a gnome, fairy, pixie, and a leprechaun. We're supposed to sit in a line. How many different ways can they sit if the elf and the gnome insist on sitting next to each other? Okay. The elf and the gnome have to be next to each other. So there's only 2 ways for them to sit next to each other, right? So let's go ahead and take care of them first. We've got 5 characters here. So either the elf sits next to the gnome first in that order, or the gnome sits next to the elf in that order. Right? So those are our two different lineups. And it doesn't matter because these are factors. It doesn't really matter which way, right? But these are taken out of the rotation. We can't really, we have one and we have two, and that's all we can do. So either of the three that are left, any one of them can sit here. Any of the others that are left can sit here, and the last one can sit here. Same thing here, same thing here, and same thing here. Right? So we have the elf and the gnome are sitting here. This is one permutation with three options here, two options here, and one here. So 3 times 2 times 1, that equals 6. Here we have another permutation. This is 1, but then we can multiply it by 3 options here, 2 options here, 1 option here. So that's another 6. So we could have 12 different permutations of the elf and the gnome sitting in the first two positions. What if they don't sit in the first two positions? What if we sit in a different order? Okay. Well, if we sit in a different order, then we have 12. I'm going to just write their names, E and G, G and E. And then this would be 2, this is 3, and 3, and then this is 2, and this is the last guy remaining, whoever he might be. So these would be 6, and these would be 6, so that's another 12, right? So now, what if they move down a slot, if they're not second on the list? So here is our other option. We have the elf and the gnome, and then somebody last. I'm sorry, the gnome and the elf would be on the second option. So then that'd be 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1. So 6 and 6. So 12 more. And then we have a final option where they're sitting at the end. So 3, 2, 1, elf and gnome. 3, 2, 1, gnome and elf. Right? 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1. That equals 6. This equals 6. That's another 12. So we have, oh my goodness, 1, 2, 3, 4 possible scenarios. So we have 4 scenarios where the elf and the gnome are sitting in different positions with 12 permutations per scenario. So that's going to equal 48 different permutations or different ways that the little people can sit if the elf and the gnome insist on sitting next to each other. All right, so you just have to kind of think things through and don't be afraid to ask yourself questions. Well, what about this? What if they're not sitting in the first seat? What if they're sitting in the second seat? What if they're sitting in the middle? What if they're sitting at the end? You kind of have to have a little bit of an open mind to get all the questions and to knock them out. All right, so the answer to this question would have been 48. That's all I have for you in lesson 45A. Do the following practice problems, and then you can do 45B, and I'll see you there.